In this video, we're going to introduce you to organic chemistry. We're going to talk about what organic chemistry is and why it's important. Simply put, organic chemistry is the chemistry of compounds that contain carbon. And in this periodic table here, you can see carbon right there. Carbon is a very important element, as we're going to learn. It is the backbone of what we call organic life. You may have heard the term organic in referring to foods. This doesn't have anything to do with organic chemistry. Organic chemistry is just talking about things that contain carbon. So a lot of things, whether they're natural or unnatural, if they contain carbon, we say that they are organic molecules. Organic molecules often contain other things like nitrogen or oxygen, for example. We also may find halogens on organic molecules. There are, in fact, some smaller molecules that maybe there's some debate as to whether or not they're organic or inorganic. For example, carbon dioxide, CO2, a lot of people consider that to be an inorganic compound. So really, kind of the key thing when you're looking for organic compounds is look for carbons and hydrogens. If you see carbons and hydrogens, you probably have an organic compound. There may be some other things going on, right? You may have a nitrogen or an oxygen, but if you have lots of carbons and hydrogens, you probably have an organic compound. So why do we care about organic chemistry? Why is it important? Well, organic chemistry is critical to the preparation of a lot of chemicals that you find around in your household. For example, drugs. If you open up your medicine cabinet, a lot of those medicines that you have in there were probably made by an organic chemist. There are also a lot of polymers that you use day to day in your life that are probably organic based. Fuels and fuel additives, a lot of those are organic compounds. A lot of pesticides that we use in agriculture or in our backyards. Organic chemistry is also very important for understanding biological processes. For example, I've got a picture of DNA here. And DNA is an organic compound. And if we understand organic chemistry, we can apply this to understanding how our body works and how certain things happen in our DNA. We can also use organic chemistry to understand industrial processes. For example, organic chemistry is often used in recycling of certain materials. Thalidomide is a great example of why organic chemistry is important. Thalidomide was discovered in the 50s, and it was a drug that was given to women for morning sickness. Well, unfortunately, it was discovered that one form of the drug was helpful with the morning sickness. The other form was causing these horrible deformities in the babies. And so thalidomide was very quickly taken off the market and not prescribed to pregnant women. It's still used today now, sometimes for treating depression and anxiety. So you have to be very careful when you're taking it to make sure that you're not pregnant. And so one of the things that we're going to learn in this class is what are those two different forms of thalidomide and how are they related to each other? Another interesting story is the story of heroin. Salicylic acid was converted to aspirin using a chemical reaction. And the same chemical reaction was then used on morphine. And when it was used on morphine, it made heroin. And at the time, Bayer was really excited about this because they thought that they had found a way to make morphine less addictive. Now, of course, we know today that that's not the case, but it's very interesting that the same chemical reaction that converted salicylic acid to aspirin converted morphine to heroin. And if you stick with me through the whole organic chemistry sequence, we'll learn about that chemistry and how that happened. As we previously mentioned, carbon is essential to our biological processes. It makes up our DNA. It makes up so many of the molecules in our body. Let's take a minute to think about what is special about carbon that makes it the basis for life. One of the cool things that carbon can do is it can form different types of bonds, like the single bond shown here. It can also form a chain with double bonds or triple bonds. And carbon can also branch. If you look at oxygen, which is in the same row of the periodic table as carbon, you can see that it can't do that branching that carbon can do. It also really can't form double bonds or triple bonds in the chain. It can form double bonds, and we'll see some examples of that in functional groups, but then it's not going to form these really cool chains. Silicon, which is right below carbon in the periodic table, can also form four bonds, but that silicon-silicon bond is weaker than the carbon-carbon bond. And you'll also see that when silicon bonds to other elements, for example, oxygen or nitrogen, that bond is also weaker. This makes silicon-based compounds more reactive, and so this is a good reason for why silicon is not the basis of life and carbon is. Hopefully that's given you an appreciation for organic chemistry, and you want to make sure that you can identify which compounds are organic and which ones are inorganic.